In chemical burns, the alkali burns are more destructive and more dangerous than the acids because of the adherence of chemical to the ocular tissue. This is a type of, we have two pictures for alkali and acid burns. This is the alkali. You see the cornea is damaged totally, also damaged in the conjunctiva, damage to the upper and lower leg. Here, the picture with acid burns shows, you know, also damage to the conjunctiva, but still the cornea is, you know, is in good shape. You can see, still see the iris behind the cornea, and you know, there is some burns around the eye, but still here, you know, less damage than this alkali burn. How we manage all types of chemical burns? Immediate irrigation for 30 minutes. So we have to open the eye, you know, widely, and to keep irrigating, you know, the eye for 30 minutes, and we delay the patient history for later after irrigation. Then after that, the doctor will come and he will see the patient. So the nurse's responsibility is to irrigate for 30 continuously for 30 minutes. Sometimes we receive calls from another towns, and they will tell, you know, I have chemical burn, so will tell the nurse in the ER, will tell the patient immediately irrigate for 30 minutes, then come, you know, to the nearest ophthalmologist. Complications of chemical burns includes, you know, corneal scars, corneal opacities. You know, this is big corneal opacity, or you can call it also corneal scar. This is also corneal scar, you know. And neovascularization. Neovascularization means the growing of abnormal blood vessels on the surface of the cornea, because the cornea is dying. Look here, this is neovascularization here, okay? This is, you know, developed, you know, because the cornea is trying to help itself. You know, the cornea is dying, and it's, you know, it's trying to help itself, you know. This is very bad sign, because any corneal transplantation for this eye will be rejected. If you have neovascularization like that, we cannot do corneal transplantation. Any transplantation will be rejected. It will not stay healthy. And of course, permanent loss of vision from the chemical burn. Next is trauma. We have under trauma penetrating injuries, lacerations, and blunt trauma. This is penetrating, this is laceration. For penetrating injuries, an object enters the eye and goes deep into the tissue. This is a piece of glass. This is a piece of glass. Penetrate the eye and rest on the retina. So you have to, you know, search for it, find it, and after that remove it as soon as possible. This is piece of glass. It can happen from car accidents, or it can happen from explosions, you know, so many reasons, you know. In lacerations, there is penetrating of external objects such as pencils, scissors, or flying object like a pellet. There is laceration here and also in the upper leg here. Any delay in the treatment may result in serious infection, and we can lose the eye. So we consider this, you know, emergency cases that you should see immediately with no delay. In blunt trauma, there is blow to the eye. It may cause fracture to the orbital rim or wall. It can happen from, you know, using instruments in workshops, or by piece of stone, or any kind of metal. So this, you know, will affect the eye, as you see in this picture. So for blunt trauma, we apply cold compresses to stop the bleeding and decrease the swelling. Then we need to examine the eye carefully, because blunt trauma can cause a lot of problems. It can cause blurred vision. It can cause dislocated lens. This picture showing dislocated lens from blunt trauma. It can cause retinal detachment, and it can cause cataract or hyphema. Do you know hyphema? Who knows hyphema?
Accumulation of blood.
Accumulation of blood in the anterior chamber from the blunt trauma. Okay. So usually takes, you know, few weeks, and the eye can absorb the blood slowly, slowly. But we see redness. You see, you know, the eye is inflamed from the blunt trauma. So sometimes the bleeding is too much, is filling the whole, you know, anterior chamber. In this particular situation, we can take the patient to the operating room and, you know, suck, you know, the blood. But if the amount of blood is not too much, you know, we don't have to do anything. The eye itself will absorb, you know, the blood slowly, slowly, during, you know, several weeks. The next true emergency case is sudden painless loss of vision. Patient coming to the ER with sudden painless loss of vision, they should be seen immediately, with no waiting, with no numbers, or, you know, because they can lose their vision immediately. Usually, this is caused by central retinal artery occlusion. This is a healthy retina. Always, the pictures of healthy retina is reddish like that. But when you see a picture and the retina appears pale like that, okay, that means there is no blood circulation in this retina. No blood circulation, okay? That means the retina will die. Or specifically, the photoreceptors of the retina will die, okay? Why? Because there is no blood circulation in this retina. So it requires immediate examination and therapy within 30 to 60 minutes to avoid permanent visual loss. The aim of the treatment is to let the blood running again, you know, in the retina. So it will become like this one, okay? Here, there is no blood circulation at all. So the eye is pale, the retina is pale, and only we have here what we call it cherry red spot. How we treat these cases with sudden painless loss of vision? The treatment is ocular massage. Ocular massage means you press on the patient eye and you remove your hand. Press on the patient eye and remove your hand. Press and remove your hand. Okay, this is one way. The second way is to ask, you know, the nurse in the ER to prepare IV Diamox 500 or a pills. If you don't have, you give the patient a pill of Diamox. Do you know Diamox pills?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Or we can do, you know, AC paracentesis. Let's say we are in the desert and we have no instruments. You can get needle and fine needle and syringe. And you go from the anterior chamber, from the edge of the eye, and take some of the aqueous. Take some of the aqueous, okay? Okay, this is another treatment that we can do. And anterior chamber paracentesis is very effective. If you are out, you are not in the clinic, you are in the mall, you are in the street or attending party with your family, okay? And you don't have any way, you don't have any equipment, you take paper bag, plastic bag, put it on the patient's head and seal it, you know, tightly, and ask the patient to breathe in and out by doing like that. So what will happen? The patient will take oxygen and will produce carbon dioxide. When the patient will take his own carbon dioxide, the carbon dioxide will dilate the retinal blood vessels. When you dilate the retinal blood vessels, the embolus will move. the problem here, we have this problem because we have embolus in the central retinal artery. And this embolus or blood clot prevent the blood from moving inside the eye. Okay? So the aim is to move this. So the breath in and out of a paper bag will produce carbon dioxide. The carbon dioxide will dilate the retinal artery blood vessels. And you know, the embolus will move, then the patient will see in seconds, once more. So our aim to reinstate the blood circulation in the retina, to change it from this situation to this situation. The ocular massage and the IV diamox and the anterior chamber paracentesis, all of them will cause sudden decrease of intraocular pressure and promote rapid dilation of the retinal blood vessels, and by this the patient can see. The problem is we have to initiate our treatment as soon as possible, within 1 hour. If you are late, the patient will become blind, permanently blind in this eye. Okay? So this is one of the top emergency cases. We have to recognize it, we have to treat it immediately so we can save the vision of this patient. The urgent situation that they need treatment within hours but in the same day is acute narrow angle glaucoma, is corneal ulcers, corneal and conjunctival foreign bodies, corneal abrasions, orbital cellulitis, endophthalmitis, and retinal detachment, vitreous hemorrhage, diabetic maculopathy, acute iritis, sudden diplopia, graft rejection, and the blind peripheral eye. We'll talk about one by one, and we'll start with the acute narrow angle glaucoma. In acute narrow angle glaucoma, we have severe pain. The patient will come complaining of severe pain. And when you screen the patient and take the intraocular pressure, who can tell me what is the normal IOP between what and what? 10 to 22. According to the previous presentation, 10 to 22, correct? Yes. Now, when you take this IOP for this particular patient, the pressure will be approximately 40, 50, 60. You know, I remember one of these patients, you know, I was training some nurses in the emergency room last year, and we see one old lady, and when we check the intraocular pressure, it was 70. Okay? So, sudden rise of intraocular pressure will cause severe pain. And blurred vision, of course. The eye is red, as you see. And look to the pupil. We have non-reacting, mid-dilated pupil. And usually, the patient cannot walk. There is nausea and also vomiting. This patient that we saw in the ER, she was vomiting, okay? Out of the pain and headache and the severe eye pain. How we treat this patient? Every hospital, every glaucoma specialist has his own, way to treat the patient. But in general, you have to use topical beta blockers. Do you know what is beta blockers? The name of one of the beta blockers. Timolol. Do you know the Timolol drops? Yes. We can simply like that. You can use Timolol drops. We have also to give the patient intravenous or oral Diamox, preferably 500 milligrams. Oral glycerin also can be used. We mix the glycerin with the orange juice and let the patient drink it, and this will, you know, reduce the high intraocular pressure. Some doctors, they are using pyrocarpine 4 times, pyrocarpine, and you know, after 1 hour, we have to recheck the intraocular pressure. When you find the intraocular pressure is down, you can do laser PI. This is laser peripheral iridotomy, what we call it PI, and the aim of doing the laser is to help to get more release of, you know, the aqueous from the posterior chamber to the anterior chamber, and by this we decrease the high intraocular pressure. Some doctors are delaying the laser treatment till the next day, but you know, this is the his own decision. Some of them, they will do it at the same day after 3-4 hours when we make sure that the pressure is back to normal, because you cannot do laser with high pressure, okay? You have to make sure that the pressure is down, then you can do the laser after that. So the laser can be done at the same day or the next day. Next is corneal ulcers, and the corneal ulcers is superficial loss of the corneal tissue because of microbial infection or abrasion or contact lens wear. What is abrasion? Do you know abrasion? Very small scratch, you know, in the cornea, you know, that can get infected and it can develop corneal ulcer. Also, corneal ulcers is, you know, can be caused by contact lens wear. We see a lot of patients, and we admit them at KCASH from, you know, bad habits with contact lens wear. The sign and symptoms is severe pain and redness, tearing, swollen eyelids, corneal edema, photophobia, and of course, loss of vision. One of the diseases that can cause corneal ulcers is, you know, herpes simplex, you know, keratitis, the recurrent, as I told you before in the past presentation, that it is a recurrent problem, and the recurrent problem can affect the cornea and cause corneal ulcer, and, you know, we need also to admit this patient and to treat them during admission. The admission sometimes, takes 2 weeks or more. I see patients in the hospital, and when I ask them, they told me we are admitted for 3 weeks to treat corneal ulcer. So the treatment to be initiated immediately to avoid corneal perforation, because the corneal ulcer can cause a hole, you know, and endophthalmitis can happen, and loss of vision can happen from this. Immediately in the ER, we scrape the infected lesion, send it to the lab to identify the microorganism, and you know, we give antimicrobial medication. Why? Why we send here antimicrobial? Because sometimes it is viral infection, sometimes it is bacterial infection, sometimes it is fungal infection. Okay? So you have to identify the responsible organism, microorganism, and you treat it, you know, after you get the report from the lab. As I said, admission is necessary in certain cases. Some cases, they will come with very early superficial and, you know, small corneal ulcer that we can, you know, give treatment and the patient can go home, especially if the corneal ulcer is away, you know, or at the peripheral part of the cornea. So some cases needs no admission, but the majority will admit them. Next is corneal and conjunctival foreign bodies. And foreign bodies can be from wood or small pieces of paper or metal. And sometimes you see it like this one, sometimes you cannot see it because it is very small. I remember one VIP, he came to our hospital, and you know, the doctor examined him, and he told him, I have foreign body sensation. He said, no. You know, I examined the eye very carefully. there is no foreign body sensation there. The VIP went home, coming the following day, I have foreign body, I cannot open, I have photophobia, I have pain, my eye turned red. No, another doctor came and he examined the patient and he told him, no, you don't have anything. You know, lubricants, give the patient tears natural free and give the patient, you know, lubricant ointment. The patient came on the third day. Then he requested that the medical director of the hospital to come and see him. The medical director used the fluorescein drops, the orange drops, and he found, you know, the foreign body. It was very, very, very small piece of sand. The VIP was in his farm, and he was, you know, with the horses, you know, and very, very small piece of sand was, we found it in his arm. So this will cause a lot of annoyment for the patient, foreign body sensation, photophobia, tearing, blepharospasm. Who knows what is blepharospasm? The patient cannot open his eye. He will try to open, he cannot, he will close out of the pain and photophobia. Try to open, will close again. Try to open, will close again. Out of the pain, okay, and the photophobia. This is the blepharospasm caused by the foreign bodies. And of course, there is pain. So most of the doctors, they use the fluorescein and the cobalt blue filter of the slit lamp to, you know, to find the foreign bodies. And also corneal abrasions, also we use the same with corneal abrasions because some of them are very, very, very small. In corneal abrasions, they are superficial scratches and erosion of the cornea, like this one here. And it causes also pain, foreign body sensation, extreme photophobia, okay, and blurred vision, and also blepharospasm. After some patients, they are coming like that, with very red eye. Okay, some of them, the eye is slightly red, but foreign body sensation is there, and the patient cannot open his eye. What is the treatment? We treat the patient with cycloplegic drops. What is cycloplegic? This is dilating drops. This cycloplegic will decrease the pain. Will decrease the pain in the patient's eye. We give antibiotic ointment and pressure patch, as you see, to immobilize, you know, the upper lid, okay? So the epithelial cells can, you know, heal quickly. Or you use bandage contact lens. Sometimes we use bandage contact lens because the other eye is blind. How come you will cover this eye and the other eye is blind? The patient will not be able to see. Okay? Or this eye is hand motion. Okay? So in this particular situation, you have the choice to use the bandage contact lens. Okay, but if the other eye has good vision, you can patch. Patching is better. And you prescribe some Panadol for the patient. And we advise all not to give the patient any anesthetic drops to take home, because the anesthetic drops will, you know, most of the patient like these drops because the pain will disappear in seconds when you use one of these drops. But these drops can damage the cornea, so we don't like to prescribe it or to give it to any patient. The next is orbital cellulitis. And the orbital cellulitis is infection of the orbital content. In most of the cases, it is caused by bacterial infection. It is potentially blinding and life-threatening, especially in children. There is so many cases that they died in the States from the orbital cellulitis, okay, because of wrong diagnosis. So especially in children, we have to admit and we have to treat as soon as possible. This problem is resulting from spread of infection from the adjacent, you know, sinuses, we need to do CT or MRI and, you know, to correctly diagnose the patient and prescribe the needed antibiotics. In adults, no need to admit the patient. This is not the same treatment. You know, in children, we admit, in adults, we give medication and the patient can go home. The signs and symptoms of orbital cellulitis includes unilateral swollen eyelids. It is only happening in one eye, never in both eyes. Swelling of the orbital tissue, proptosis, double vision, decreased vision, and headache, pain, redness, limitation of eye movement. If you pull the upper lid, try to touch the patient's eye, the patient will cry. Open the upper lid and ask the patient to look to the right or to the left. He cannot. He cannot. And always, the patient will come with fever. All of them will come with fever. So all of this will confirm that the patient has orbital cellulitis. In case of children, admission is necessary. Adults will prescribe medication and the patient will go home with the medication. When we admit the patient, you have to give IV antibiotics immediately. Sometimes in the ER, we start the IV in the ER after the diagnosis. Some of the patients, they need drainage surgery for the orbital abscess in case we have orbital abscess. And also some of them, they need sinusitis treatment. And during admission, we re-evaluate the children every 4 hours. Next is endophthalmitis. Endophthalmitis, we see a lot at Kekesh. Why? Why we see a lot of endophthalmitis at Kekesh? Because most of the patients are referred from other hospitals. They are referred from the Eastern Province, the Western Province, the South of the Kingdom, the North of the Kingdom. All of them, they will come with urgent report for admission. And when we look or in the report, you will find that the patient has endophthalmitis, okay? What can cause endophthalmitis? First of all, it is severe inflammation inside the eye. Where inside the eye? In the vitreous. It is in the vitreous, okay? It can happen from trauma. It can happen from uveitis or inflammation of the uvea. It can happen post-operatively. After cataract surgery, it is possible. After glaucoma, it is possible. After any corneal graft, it is possible. You know, any intraocular pressure, you know, can cause endophthalmitis. The signs and symptoms, redness, hypopia. Who knows what is hypopia? Look, this is the hypopia here. Accumulation of pus or inflammatory cells in the anterior chamber. Okay? So, redness, hypopia, decreased vision, and pain, lid edema, and of course, corneal haze. The treatment of endophthalmitis includes aqueous and vitreous sample, and you need to send this immediately to the lab, you know, to identify the responsible or the involved microorganism. We usually give the patient intravitreal injection of antibiotics, usually vancomycin. Okay, this is very strong, widespread antibiotic, and you know, we wait few hours to watch the patient. Some cases will improve after the injection, some patient, no improvement. No improvement, you will take the patient to the operating room to do vitrectomy. Why vitrectomy? Because the infection is in the vitreous. The infection is in the vitreous. Okay, so we have to do vitrectomy, remove or excise the vitreous, okay, and admit the patient, of course, for several days until the patient is okay. Unfortunately, we can save the patient's eye, but we cannot improve the vision. The vision with endophthalmitis, usually some patients go to very poor vision after excellent treatment and excellent operation. We cannot guarantee that the patient will benefit, you know, and the vision will improve. We can save the eye after the vitrectomy, but not the vision. Any delay in treatment may cause permanent visual loss. This is very serious, should be treated and, you know, at the same moment in the ER. In the previous presentation, we took quickly on retina detachment, and I said it is separation of the retina from the retinal pigment epithelium, and, you know, it causes progressive loss of visual field. Sometimes part of the field is affected like that. Sometimes the lower half of the visual field is, you know, involved, and the patient cannot see with the lower field of vision. Sometimes the upper field of vision. Sometimes we have, you know, total loss of vision if all the retina is detached. Okay? The patient usually will complain of flashes that followed by floaters. And, you know, when we dilate and examine the retina, we will find gray and wrinkled retina. Immediately, we schedule the patient for surgery, you know, in the following day, because we have, you know, busy operating rooms in Kekesh. We cannot, you know, operate on the same day. Next is, again, let's stress on one point, that some patient will come with small part of the retina detached, you know, and the rest of retina is okay, the macula is okay. If the macula is on and not detached, the patient will gain good vision after surgery. If we have detachment and also the macula is detached, the patient after surgery will lose his central vision. So he will benefit from his peripheral vision, and the peripheral vision is not so good like central vision, okay? And sometimes there is total detachment, means the whole retina detached. This is very difficult to treat, very difficult, okay? We can help the patient, but the vision will be very poor after the surgery. Vitreous hemorrhage causes sudden painless decrease of vision due to bleeding in the vitreous. So we call it vitreous hemorrhage, but the hemorrhage is not from the vitreous. The hemorrhage is from where? Who knows? The hemorrhage is from the retinal blood vessels. Okay, the retinal blood vessels, you know, especially in diabetic patients, as we said in the previous talk, they develop neovascularization, new abnormal blood vessels, and these new abnormal blood vessels are very weak. They can break easily and bleed easily. So the blood will be there, and it will cause, you know, loss of vision. The patient will come complaining of showers of floaters, so many floaters moving in front of his eye, complete loss of vision, and, you know, when we dilate the patient and examine his retina, we'll find accumulation of blood between the vitreous and the retina. So the blood is coming from the retina, and but we call it vitreous hemorrhage. The treatments, we do ultrasound because we cannot, in some cases, see clearly the you know, the retina. So to exclude retinal detachment or tumors, most of the doctors will give the patient 1 month or more and give him, you know, another appointment to see it, because some eyes can absorb the blood spontaneously without any treatment. If not, when the patient will come back next visit and the doctor, you know, he found the blood as it is or more than before, he will schedule the patient to do vitrectomy. We need to remove the vitreous and to inject special saline solution to replace the vitreous. Before the surgery, we need to stop the aspirin or warfarin given to the patient. And also after the treatment, we have to do some laser, you know, to treat the neovascularization that we found in the retina. So the problem with vitreous hemorrhage, that the same patient will come after some time with new bleeding, okay, and we have to repeat what I said, you know. This is a common problem in diabetic patients. Also in diabetic patients, we have a lot coming with diabetic macropathy. It is visual distortion due to accumulation of fluids near the macula. Some other people, they call this macular edema, okay? So, the late treatment causes permanent loss of central vision in this patient, so we have to treat the patient immediately. The signs and symptoms of diabetic maculopathy or macular edema is swelling of the central retina. All the central retina, the area of the macula, will be swelled, okay? There is leaking blood vessels there and pale fatty deposits around the macula, and of course reduced vision, and the patient will develop blurred vision or metamorphopsia. The patient will not see, you know, everything as it is. He will get zigzag you know, a picture for the straightforward things. We call this metamorphopsia, and we have a test that we call it Amsler grid test that we need to do it for this patient with this problem, because they see everything like, you know, not straight but zigzag. We call this metamorphopsia. How we treat patients with diabetic maculopathy? We treat them with intravitreal Avastin injection. Usually we give three injections, one injection every month, okay? Some patients will improve, some patients will not improve. For the patient that they don't improve from the Avastin injection, we give another three injections. Okay, if no improvement, we give another three injections. I see patients in our hospital and they told me we took total of nine Avastin injections. There is another medication. If Avastin is not working, we can change to Lucentis. This is another more expensive treatment. We can. Some doctors, you know, if Avastin is not so good, we go to Lucentis. Also, we do for this patient argon laser around the macula. Okay, you know, it depends on the doctor's decision. But the first line of treatment is Avastin injection. Anterior uveitis or acute iritis is very common, and we have at KCASH several doctors working you know, to see these patients. I remember we used to have one only physician. Now we have more than 10 physicians at KCASH to see cases with uveitis. It is severe inflammation due to systemic diseases, or it can be idiopathic. Idiopathic means without known reason, without any known reason. Okay? So the patient will come with red eye like that, foreign body. It can happen also from, you know, foreign bodies, from trauma, from systemic conditions, as we said. The patient will come with redness, deep ocular pain, decreased vision, photophobia, and you know, he will tell you, I have discomfort, I'm not happy. You know, there is something wrong with my eye. The pain is continuous, you know, and anterior uveitis can cause some complications. Look to this pupil and tell me, is the pupil round and nice? No, not round, not regular pupil, okay? Why? Because when the iris is inflamed, okay, the next tissue is the lens. What happens is the iris will adhere to the lens, and this adherence will be permanent. Permanent. You cannot break it once more. It is like you put glue between the iris and the lens. Okay? And we call this posterior synechia. We call this posterior synechia, okay? And you know, this is one of the complications of the anterior uveitis. Also, anterior uveitis can cause cataract and can cause glaucoma. The cataract and the glaucoma is also complications of the anterior uveitis. The treatment is cycloplegics, because when you keep the eye dilated, you know, you will prevent this posterior synechia, and anti-inflammatory medication. Some patients will not respond to the anti-inflammatory, so you need to add immunosuppressive medication like cyclosporine or Imuran. So this is all the treatment for, but can we change this picture? No, the patient will stay all his life like that. Yeah, this is what we call it posterior synechia, or adherence between the lens and the iris. Sudden onset of diplopia is another serious condition that we need to see immediately. Happening because of nerve paralysis in diabetic and hypertensive patients. It can happen from brain tumor or strokes, from trauma, or from thyroid eye disease. We need to do full eye exam to find why the patient is developing diplopia. The treatment in some cases is so simple: eyeglasses with prisms, okay? We do some eye exercises for some other patients, or muscle surgery if needed, and we treat some patients just with Botox injections. So we have a lot of options, treatment options, and we have to choose, you know, what is necessary for this particular patient. Sometimes you have a brain tumor, and the cause of the double vision is brain tumor. Sometimes, so you have to do brain surgery. Some of them, they have diabetes, and the treatment is to control the diabetes. Then, you know, the patient will be back to normal. Some of them from trauma that affects one or two of the extraocular muscles. So, you know, some of them, you know, because nerve paralysis, you know, some of them from thyroid eye disease. So the treatment options is not the same for everyone. Thank you. Do we still have time? Yes. But quickly, I have two slides. Corneal graft rejection is also coming to the emergency room. It may occur within weeks or several years after the surgery. This is a patient with corneal graft, PKP. The graft looks cloudy and dull. it can happen from infection or trauma or bruise or broken sutures. So whenever we see broken or loose suture, we have to remove and we have to treat the patient. The patient will come with progressive blurred vision, pain and redness, epithelial defects, inflammatory cells and flare there in the eye. We admit this patient. Some of them need no admission, but some we have to admit. We need to remove the broken or loose sutures, and we give prednisolone drops hourly. The last slide is about blind, painful eyes, and this is, you know, the patient will not be able to sleep out of the pain. Usually it is, you know, with patient with end-stage glaucoma, the patient has glaucoma for 30 years, 40 years, or chronic retinal detachment, trauma, that's post-endophthalmitis, or treatment, or failed graft, from failed graft. For these patients, as I said, some of them they have moderate, but most of them they have severe pain, and they will tell you, I cannot sleep out of the pain. The eye is red and there is visual loss. We give the patient atropine, anti-inflammatory drops, retrobarbar alcohol injection, and you know, it, the retrobarbar alcohol injection can, you know, treat the pain, but the problem with this treatment that it will stay only for 1 year. It will not stay forever. So every year the patient has to come again to take this retrobarbar alcohol injection. We need to discuss the enucleation with the patient, because if the eye is blind and the eye starts to shrink, to become smaller, okay, the solution is to do enucleation. The best solution is to do enucleation. But some patients refuse. If the patient refuses enucleation, the only available treatment is retrobarbar alcohol injection, and it will stay only for 1 year, no more. Then next year the patient has to come to take another injection, every year like that. Okay, but still enucleation is the best. Thank you very much. I need to stop here, and you know, it's the time. Thank you.